A lot of the time when I'm talking about technique, even making tools, I emphasize precision and accuracy and efficiency. But something that's not really talked about much at all is marking out and layout, using your scriber, your ruler, and your dividers. I'm always amused when I see people using photocopies and they've glued them on paper for cutting out designs. I suppose that's fine if that's what you're aiming for. What I would argue is that you're not going to develop your technique at all if you're not, if you don't have a very precise aim. You're always just going to be roughly in the ballpark. And if you want to do fine work, elegant work, it's really important that you start off with a precise and clear understanding of what you're trying to do. Both metaphorically speaking, you need to know where you're trying to go, but also in terms of actual material layout and marking. So I've been playing with something that I quite enjoy today and doing it on metal. I'll explain in a moment. And it occurred to me that this is a really excellent exercise for developing your marking out and layout skills. So we'll talk about that today. This is a pretty standard metalworker's compass of the type sold in jewelry starter kits and by pretty much every jewelry tool supply store. I'll be honest, I think they're absurd. They are so clunky and large and, well, just awkward, really. I can't imagine how you'd be considering making elegant pieces of jewelry or just fine metalwork with something like this. And I just don't know how you are supposed to be marking out anything fine and precise with something this heavy. It's a good compass, but I don't think it has a place in a goldsmith's toolbox, to be absolutely blunt. That's my opinion. So we'll put that aside. Those of you who have followed me for a while will know I am a firm fan of the Starrett brand. This is the one that's available now. This is the 3-inch Starrett. They're not inexpensive, but if you can get a good pair of the old 2-inch, I think you won't be disappointed. I found this one, I don't know, maybe 30 years ago. I've subsequently found a couple of older ones. I bought actually a prettier pair, an earlier model, this size for Bella, which I'm quite envious of, to be honest. But when you've got a pair of dividers this size, you really are able to work very delicately. And what I particularly like about these, when you close them up, the tips do meet. I've fettled them a little bit, I've polished them, made sure those two points do come together. You'll notice one is ever so slightly longer than the other. That's so that you can use the dividers on the edge of a piece of metal and run down the side. But as you can see, just holding it, it's such a small and delicate tool. I feel completely confident in marking out the finest and most precise patterns I need to. So that's the compass or dividers that I use. You could get by with the 3-inch pair, but as I say, if you can get hold of a pair of these, that's fantastic. There is another option. As I say, there's an alternative that I came across by accident the other day. I've had a small, I think it was an Eclipse pencil compass, a small one, in my workshop for the last 25, 30 years. And it finally died a couple of weeks ago. The thread in the center wore out. I went online and I found this one. This is old stock. It's a Kern Swiss compass. It does seem that most manufacturers today who are making these small compasses are making them really rather bulky. I don't know why that's the contemporary feel. But I got these. I would suggest having a dig around on eBay to find this kind of thing. At the present, it's set up as a pencil divider. However, it comes with alternatives. So you can take that out And let's get that one in there. There we go. And here is a metal one. And there you have a perfectly serviceable metal compass, perhaps even more delicate and elegant than the Starrett. And if I consider that the Starrett cost me about £45, this cost me 12. This is also a pencil compass. If you can find these, that's my top tip. Go for one. They're really very elegant. Also, when you find old compasses like this, these metal points make fantastic scribers. I've got a couple that I've used over the years. They're really handy. So either of those make fantastic, because they're hardened steel, so they make really very good compasses. I'm not going to use this for this demonstration, although I'm tempted because it looks so delicate. I'll stick with the old Starrett. Right. So for pin vise, or rather for scriber, you can buy scribers. This is an old German scriber. It was about that long when it was new. It had a burnisher on the other end. Long since been taken down, repeated sharpenings. It now serves as an alternative small burnisher. This is what I use as a scriber nowadays. That's a piece of, I think again, it was a pin from an old compass, hardened steel, in a pin vise. I just find this more accurate. It doesn't have to be a pin vise, it could be a piece of wood, whatever. The reason being, I want a nice sharp point where I can get in as close to a ruler edge, or if I've got a pinpoint that is my starting point for a line, I really want to get on that line. Where we lose accuracy is in the thickness of the lines we're marking out with. There's the old joke about choose your favorite ethnicity to denigrate here. The definition of such and such a people's precision is marking it, was it measuring it with a micrometer, marking it with chalk, and cutting it with an axe. That's the old joke. And there's something to be said. There's an element of truth there. It's all good and well if you've got all these clever measuring devices and you can measure to within, you know, a 50th of a millimeter, and then you're using a Sharpie to mark out. You've lost a millimeter there, right there, because of the thickness of the marker pen. And then, of course, you're trying to cut to a line that doesn't exist. You're trying to work to an average. So the absurdity of that situation is apparent immediately. So what we're trying to do is create lines of the very least dimension possible. Okay. I've just been advised by my cinematographer and director that I need to advise you that if you're noticing some interesting light play on this wonderful composition that has just accidentally happened on my bench, it's because it's quite windy today, so we're getting reflections off the trees coming through the window, and it's creating this whole arty effect. Are we going for the Vermeer-esque look today?
Yeah.
So there's that. Right, so I'm going to do a little exercise. And what I've been doing is I've been using this book by John Allen, Drawing Geometry, A Primer of Basic Forms for Artists, Designers, and Architects. It's $25, $12.99. I think it was cheaper than that on Amazon. And it's brilliant fun. It starts off with really basic things. And apart from just being good fun and a good exercise, there's actually a lot of practical application. And for all of the geometric forms that you're trying to achieve, a number of methods are offered. I've actually got a real reason for wanting to study these. They've always intrigued me. When I was a teenager, I used to build card models of three-dimensional geometric forms. But this kind of geometry has always been very satisfying. Drawing them very precisely with metalworking tools is something quite magical about it. So I'm recommending this now as a meditative practice, but also as a way of improving your precision and accuracy and getting you in the right state of mind for the work to follow. So what we're going to do now is we're going to do a basic procedure to draw a pentagon. In fact, I have to do a pentagon, so there's that. And we're going to do this one. It's a method that was devised, apparently, was first revealed and used by Albrecht Dürer, he of the German Renaissance, who liked painting himself as Jesus, and who wouldn't if you've got that hair. Right, so I'm going to follow the instructions. On a line AB, draw two circles with a radius AB. So I've set my dividers to a suitable diameter, and I'm now going to draw a line on this piece of brass. I've polished it with Scotch stone, so it's got a nice matte finish so that you can see what I'm doing. So I've placed my ruler in the center of the piece of brass. I'm not concerned about using up the whole thing. I just want to make it very clear, or as clear as I can for you. So I'm holding the ruler nice and tight. It's a very thin steel rule. I'm placing my scriber up against the brass, and I want to get that tip right up against the steel. Firm pressure, drag it along, and maybe once more for good luck. Right, there's my line. That's my starting line. Is that visible? So I've scribed a line, and I've set my compass. Now, I want to make 2 points on the line. So here's the trick. Very gently drag the compass along until I feel it catch in the line. Remember the groove now, the scribe line is a groove. Oop, I felt that tip go in. Now I can just press it down. Now, having done the one, I can go on the other line, the other point, and I've felt it click in the groove, and I can press it down. Now I have two marks on the line. There. I wouldn't use a center punch or a punch to indent these because the holes will be too big. And it again introduces too much variation and wobble. Now, the instructions call for two circles. Now, I could have it like this and I could rotate it, which is, I suppose, what we learn in school. That's not going to work, as most of you, if you've tried this, will recognize. What's going to happen is you're going to turn around, and then suddenly the outer arm that's swinging will catch, and the center point will come out. If you try to do it like this, where you stick the one end in, and you simply rotate it round, what often happens is, if you're not careful... Oh, see,
not there, to you.
Not to me. Right, so what frequently happens is you've got one end in, and you start turning it, and at that point, the weight transfers, and then this end comes out. Or the tip in the center doesn't have enough pressure applied on it, and the center point moves. So what I try to do is eliminate that, and I'll put one end in one of the holes, or the little dimples I have there, feel it. And now in my hand, using both my left and right hands, I will move the metal. Okay. And I won't try to do it all in one go. Move it around, pick it up again. And it went through the center of the other dot, of course. Go back in, very carefully put it in the same dot. And, oop, even there, it wanted to slip out. And I'm keeping very careful pressure where I need it. So I have my first circle. Is that okay?
Yeah, it's in and out of focus, but that's okay.
Now going back to the second hole, nope, on the edge. And I will do the same again. Holding the metal in my hand. And there we have it. Two circles on the line. Now, we're asked to find the intersection of two of the circles. Now here we can either use the dividers or my scriber. I'm going to use the scriber. And you've really got to feel, again, feel the scribe line. Ah, and I can just feel where they intersect. And I'm dipping the scribe vertical and press it down. Yep, I think that is on the money. And now I need to do another circle off that point with the same radius as the others. Here we go again. And of course they intersect and you'll hear that satisfying little click as you go through the other indents. Of course, each one reassuring you that you're maintaining your accuracy. So now we have our three intersecting circles. And now I'm required to draw a line from that point to this intersection. This will then provide a 90 degree line through this horizontal line that we started off. All right, so to do that, I need to do what we did here, put it on the line and very gently feel it. There it is, the intersection, and press down. All right. Now using my ruler, I offer it up to those lines. What I do to start with, I put the scriber point back in that little indent I just made. And I bring the ruler up to it. And then pivoting off that, I move it along until it's pretty much to the center of the other hole on the other side. Right? Making sure I'm still in that hole there. I then drag it through and click. Yes, I got it. Let me just extend the line. Click, click, got it. So now I have a line, goes through these two intersections and is at 90 degrees to this initial horizontal line. Now, I just want to emphasize, I'm not trying to show you how to make a hexagon, or the pentagon rather. By the book, they're all in there, they're great fun. What I'm trying to show you is how I achieve accuracy and precision in doing very delicate mark out. Okay, right, so that's the first step. Now, what do they say to do? From D, draw a line through F to cut circle B at H. From D, draw a line through F to cut circle B at H. Yeah, I can do that. This is D. Again, I need to mark the intersection of two circles. D, and I'm going to go through there, where that intersects the line there, and we'll come out that side. So, similarly, as before, I'm going to put my scriber on the dot I've just made, these two circles intersecting. There it is. Offer it up. I'm doing it the wrong way around. So you can see, and as that circle goes to that vertical there, I offer it. It's there, I think. I can't see it. I'm just going to check here. Okay. I think I can do this. Very lightly. Yep, it's there. I clicked. So let's do it again. Click, click, and through. It goes through. That's another mark point we need. So I'm going to mark that now. So I simply placed it on that scribe line, dragged it up until I felt it touch the circle, marked it. Now I have to do the same from here, through there, out there. So find that point. I'm really trying to be very sensitive and feel the little ridges of the scribe lines. I'm going to do it back to front again so you can see. Put my scriber in there. The ruler's up against it. Pivot it. I think that's okay. I'm going to come forward just to see. Yep, there it is. No, I'm trying to hold it steady because I'm awkward now. Click, click, and out. Yeah. Ever so slightly off because I didn't have the ruler exactly on because I was looking from the wrong side. So don't do that. But you won't have a camera documenting your every move. Right, so there we have that line cleared. So, where are we? So, there's the base of our pentagon. There's the first side. There's the second side. Now we need two more, because the apex will be up here. Right, so let's find out how we get to the apex. From points H and G and with radius AB. Okay, there we go. The radius AB, which is the original initial radius we started with. Let me just check that I've still got that. Yep, there we have it. So I've just checked that that's the initial radius we started with, AB. Now, with that radius, draw arcs to intersect on the vertical from points G and H. So this point, clip it into the hole again, and I do a little cross over here on that vertical, go to the other side, put it back in the hole, click. Is that right? That's not right. I'm off. See, this is where that line being off has caught me out. So that, presumably, is the third line. Now, this is going to be embarrassing because it's off slightly. So putting the scriber in that dot there, I need to draw a line to that intersection there. Again, feel it. Draw the line. There it is. I'm just going softly at this point. Just a light line. And no, that's fine. What? It'll be okay. Swing it back. Very lightly. Scribe it in. And so now the geometry is all clear. That's one side. That's two sides. That's the third. The fourth. And the fifth, the original line. So there's your pentagon. I'm now going to draw it in firmly using the lines I have. So I can put my scriber in the little indented hole, pivot it to meet the one here, and now I'm going to make it quite a firm line. There we go, click and click. Go to this hole there, feel it lock in, locked in place, pivot the ruler and click. Come back to this dot here. Pivot the ruler to meet that one up here. Click, click, as it reaches the end. Into that little divot at the end. And click, end to end. And in there. and to finish off. So we're going to known little dimples we've indented in the metal. And so there it is. So it was a bit messy because I try and get my hands out of the way. So I made some deviations, and you can see it's not as accurate as it might have been. But here's one I did earlier, using exactly the same principles. That being, using your dividers to make little dimples, finding those dimples again, locking your point of your scriber or your divider in a hole. And you've really got to feel it carefully. You can't afford to go back and forth and be mangling up the holes and, oh, allowing a quarter of a millimeter to creep in here or there. Because as you saw here, the slightest deviation will throw everything else out. Now, it doesn't mean you have to work like this all the time. However, if you can get used to doing this kind of thing just for fun, what it means is your precision and delicacy and your lightness of touch will be much enhanced. And when you come to laying things out and marking things out, it's just another skill that you really do need. If you want to cut out a square of metal and you want to file it up, it's not very helpful if your initial marking out isn't square. And as I say, with a book like this, with all these wonderful examples as exercises, it really is great fun to develop these skills. I did this one earlier, seven-sided, and it really is very satisfying. Really very complex, these tiny little shapes. What are they called? Vesica. These vesica shapes. I didn't know what a vesica was. Now I do, because you've got to learn the lingo. And then, of course, you sound far more educated than perhaps we really are. Interestingly enough, they talk about accuracy. Using the method, you can get 99.66% accuracy. Not all of the methods provide that level of accuracy. I haven't quite figured out how that is. I would have thought geometry, being a pure science, would have allowed for perfect accuracy, but maybe that's the human error sneaking in. But we'll have none of that here. Anyway, I hope all that helps. Good fun. My geometry will incorporate skeletons, but that's another matter.